Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, we're very Lutheran here today. Everyone is sitting in like the back three rows. That is amazing. A couple of changes y'all heard that are here. So for those of you online, we are changing some things up. The original intent, we had a lot of new music today, and with so few people here in person because of the snow, we are changing up the music to things that are a little bit more familiar, so that we can sing together. I'm gonna ask for your patience because I'll be playing it and I didn't practice this ahead of time, so it should go okay, but if it doesn't, blame the snow. It's good. So that is probably the only big change that'll happen to the service is the hymns. Everything else will go. It's a short service anyways, so this will work out well. We are delaying the voters meeting till next week. However, for those of you who are online, you're missing out because we have four different kinds of chili here for like 20 of us. No one can leave until all the chili is gone. I don't want to take leftovers home. You want to take leftovers home. Okay, you get all the leftovers. All right. One other announcement. This Tuesday, 7 p.m. is the Jesus Cares training session. If you can come, please come to that. That's the special worship service designed for those with special needs, like Down syndrome and Tourette's. It is an hour-long training session, Tuesday at 7 p.m. All right.
Pastor Gertner will be here for
Pastor
that.
Gertner will be here for that. If you can't come and you want to be involved, let me know. We will still hook you up. But it is better, of course, to be there in person. So, yes, Pastor Gertner will be here doing the training. He is the guy who's in charge of it nationally. So, yeah, that's the news. Let's get started. We're going to sing hymn 752, In Christ Alone.
In Christ alone, my hope is found.
we come to meet with Christ, let's stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
We've come into the presence of God who created us to love him and to serve him as his own dear children. But we have disobeyed him. We deserve only his wrath and his punishment. So let's confess our sins to him and plead for his mercy. We confess our sins together. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sin and take away my guilt. God, our Heavenly Father, has forgiven all of your sins. By the perfect life and innocent death of our Lord Jesus Christ, he's removed your guilt forever. You are his own dear child. Now may God give you strength to live according to his will.
Amen.
And the peace of forgiveness, let's praise the Lord. God, you sent your Son to proclaim your kingdom and to teach with authority. Anoint us with the power of your Spirit that we too may bring good news to the afflicted, bind up the brokenhearted, and proclaim liberty to the captive. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. They didn't matter. You're going to hear both here and then in our gospel that Jesus came to the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and that is kind of a weird thing. The best comparison would be, can you imagine someone running for U.S. president and announcing his candidacy in Mandan, North Dakota? In North Dakota, which is not exactly a popular state and not even the biggest city in the state, be really dumb. People in Mandan really don't matter to a president. Who cares? Whatever way they vote, it's not going to matter. But Jesus said no. Zebulun and Naphtali, these little know-nothing things that don't matter, they matter to him. And he was going to start his ministry there. Our first lesson is from Isaiah chapters 8 and 9. When men tell you to consult mediums and spiritists who whisper and mutter, shouldn't the people inquire of their God? Why consult the dead on behalf of the living, to law, to the testimony? If they don't speak according to this word, they have no light of dawn. Distressed and hungry, they'll roam through the land. When they're famished, they'll become enraged, and looking upward, they'll curse their king and their God. Then they'll look toward the earth and see only distress and darkness and fearful gloom, and they'll be thrust into utter darkness. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, he humbled the land of Naphtali and the land of Zebulun. But in the future, he will honor Galilee of the Gentiles by the way of the sea along the Jordan. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. This is God's Word. We're going to continue with Psalm 27. We are going to sing the refrain, speak the verses responsively, as we say, God, you are the one we trust.
Galilee of the Gentiles,
The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. From that time on, Jesus began to preach, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near." As Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter and his brother Andrew. They were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. "Come follow me," Jesus said. "I'll make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They were in a boat with their father Zebedee, preparing their nets. Jesus called them, and immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. This is God's gospel. Please be seated. I said that we were only going to sing songs today that were well known. I'm sorry, I lied. We're going to sing song 379 now. Maybe a few of you are familiar with it. It's called Amazing Grace. Okay, there's 16 of us sitting here right now. One of us is standing. I don't know how many of you are online, but my guess is that sitting with you, there's less than 16 people. Do you matter? This is a tiny amount. Should we just forget it? It doesn't matter. Well, some of you have been around enough. Actually, I know all of you that are in this room personally. I think I've told all of you one way or another, you matter. Sometimes I've told you that in those exact words, you matter. And some of you have picked up on this and have said it back to me, that I matter. And that's really awesome. I don't know about you, but when I hear that, it feels good. And there's a reason for that. Because this world screams, you don't matter. unless. Your church doesn't matter unless it's at least kind of full.
Yeah.
You don't matter unless certain people approve of you. Maybe your teacher, your parents, a significant other, friends, co-workers, that if they don't approve of you, you don't matter. You don't matter unless you make a certain amount of money. You don't matter unless you have a certain kind of job. You don't want to be burger flipper your whole life, do you? You don't matter unless you get a certain amount done. You're supposed to do so much every day, and if you just sit and play computer all day, you're just online, well, clearly you don't matter. That's what the world says. You don't matter unless. Who's right? I'm just some dork standing in the front of a church in a white robe. The whole world shouts, you don't matter unless. I say you do. Who's right? I want to tell you about a guy named John. Last week we talked about a guy named John the Baptizer. This is a different John. Just like there's a bunch of people named Jennifer in this world, you probably know like 30 of them. There were a lot of people back then named John. This is a different John. This was little brother John. And I don't know if anyone here is a little brother. I'm not. But I know enough little brothers to know that sometimes little brothers get ignored. Sometimes little brothers feel like they're not that important. And sometimes their families let them. John was a little brother. In fact, he ended up becoming one of the three most important disciples of Jesus. But maybe if you've heard that, it's always Peter, James, and John. He's always the last one. It's because James was his older brother. He always came first. John didn't matter. And he lived in a town that didn't matter. I grew up in North Dakota. I very rarely have anyone say, North Dakota, wow, that is so awesome! Often enough, it's jokes or pity. Wow, you grew up there. That's where John grew up. Not North Dakota, but the North Dakota of Israel. An area called Galilee. And he didn't just grow up in a town in Galilee. He grew up in Capernaum, which wasn't even important enough to be a Jewish town. It was half Jewish, half Gentile, which meant if you're Jewish, it was really a junk place to live. And he didn't have an important job. He was a fisherman. He smelled like fish guts. The entire world shouted at John, "You don't matter." Well, James one day heard about this guy, this baptizing guy, and James brought his little brother with, and the two of them got to listen to this baptizer guy, and they listened for a while. They got to be there for a little bit, and John treated them as if they were important. In fact, the book of John tells us that they were actually the baptizer's disciples. So the baptizer treated John as if he mattered. And then one day, the baptizer points and goes, "Look, the Lamb of God who comes to take away the sin of the world." And James sort of nudges his little brother and says, "Hey, we got to check this out." And they go and they meet this lamb who ends up being named Jesus. I don't think that's a surprise to any of you who are in here today. And Jesus treats John as if he matters. Jesus invites John and big brother James to come follow him. And they follow him for a little bit. In fact, John gets to be a witness to Jesus' very first miracle, turning water into wine. And then the baptizer was thrown into prison. Have you ever had something where you thought you had something that made you matter, and that thing was taken away from you? Maybe it was a relationship, maybe it was a job. I don't know what it was, but my guess is that you've lived through that. This thing makes me matter, and now I've lost it. That's what happened. The baptizer was put in prison. This thing that made John matter, he was gone. And John and big brother James just go back to work. They start fishing. And that's when Jesus does something really weird. Jesus sets up his ministry headquarters in Capernaum, in this nothing city that's only half Jewish, in this nothing area of Israel. And Jesus doesn't just set up his headquarters there. He starts teaching very purposely in earshot of where John works as a fisherman. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine someone running for president who says, I'm going to set up my headquarters in your town, and not only that, but I'm going to make sure that all my speeches are in your job, in where you can hear, because you're that important to me. That'd be incredible. That'd be crazy. But that's what Jesus does. And then one day as Jesus is teaching, he looks over at John and says, John, I want you to be with me full time. You matter to me. And so John started following. John mattered to Jesus. And you matter just as much. The world screams you don't matter unless, but you do. Jesus looks at you and says, you matter. I came to earth for you. You matter. And that, I'm hoping, makes you feel kind of warm inside. Kind of makes you go, wow, this is really cool. But there's a problem. See, the world says you don't matter unless. And because we live in the world, none of you are in heaven yet. Maybe you've realized that. That message soaks into our bones. So the first step is realizing, yes, I matter. But then what happens is we start treating the people around us as if they don't matter. It's very natural. The world works this way. I don't matter unless, so that means you don't matter unless. It's one of the reasons that we fight, that we argue. You ever do that with someone? You're from Chicago? Pfft. You cheer for that team? The Vikings? Really? What's wrong with you? I mean, that's why we do those things. Sometimes it's done out of teasing love. But what we're doing is we're trying to say, no, you're not important. You don't matter. I do. That's what gatekeepers do. I hear plenty of stories, especially of women that will wear shirts that have a band on them. And some dweeb of a guy walks up and says, really? Can you name the third album that they put out and the number three track on that album? Shut up. But we do that to each other. You don't matter unless, even that phrase, you don't want to be a burger flipper, do you? Burger flippers apparently don't matter. That's what we're saying. And so what we do is we live that way. Even when we hear Jesus says, I matter, I live as if you don't matter unless. And that's really bad. Because Jesus says, you will be judged by how you judge others. If you say that you don't matter because, Jesus is going to look at you and say, you don't matter because. And that's really scary. It's terrifying. So what do we do? Look at how Jesus showed you that you matter. He didn't just show up. It'd be incredible if someone running for U.S. president said that you matter. That would be insane. Last week, I got to attend the leadership conference in Chicago. And a black woman who's been W.E.L.s all her life gave a presentation, and she did a fantastic job. She talked about racism and how that shows up in the W.E.L.s and how to fight that. Really, really awesome. And at the beginning, I was impressed with her. She was doing a great job. She was talking well. She was talking from experience. And then she put up a picture. She was actually the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. for about 2.5 years. That's crazy! And suddenly, she mattered even more to me. Wow, look at that. But she took time to come and talk to us. Now, that's really cool. That a former UN ambassador came to talk to us. But she's never done anything for me personally. I've never met her. I never shook her hand. There were 1,300 of us at the leadership conference. I didn't get to talk to her personally at all. But Jesus didn't just show up and talk. He showed up and died. He said, you're so important to me that even knowing how you've treated others, I will die for you. And I will take your sins away. You matter so much to me that I forgive you. I don't just say, yeah, it's fine, it's all right. He said, I take your sins away. Your guilt is gone. You matter so much to me, I shed my blood for you. That's how Jesus shows you that you're important, that you matter to him. So for all the times that you treated other people like they don't matter unless you're forgiven. Now you get to be like Jesus. You matter, period. Now you get to treat other people like they matter. How do you do that? You show them love. You listen to them. You take time to spend time with them. You don't act bothered. And yeah, that means I've got plenty to confess too. And I've got plenty I've been forgiven of and need to change. Because if I matter, then you matter. And I want to express that. So yeah, even though there's just a few of us here today, even though there might be just a few people worshiping with you in person today, you matter. Now, show other people they matter too. Amen. Let's stand. Now, the peace of God that is better than anything we can understand will keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord until he returns to bring us home to life everlasting. Amen. We're going to skip ahead now to prayers. And we are not going to be doing the responsive prayer today. I have to let Barb know so she knows how to where to get to. We're going to do a prayer here. I need to find the name. We're going to be praying for Bill Donald. Bill is Rob Yake's father. Rob got on a plane this morning at 7 a.m. to get home because it looks like Bill is going to be in heaven, like he's going to be dying soon. So we'll be praying for Bill. We'll be praying for his entire family, especially Rob and Joanne. We'll be praying for Finn Bader again. Finn has started his third round of chemotherapy. However, he was able to go home for a few days, and he was playing catch with his older brother and sister, which is actually a really big deal. We've got brain cancer. Those are some of the things that you lose. And he was able to play catch, which is a really good thing to say thank you for. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We mattered enough to you that you shed your blood for us. Help us to rejoice in that. You matter to us. Help us grow in that, and help us share that others matter too. Lord, we pray especially today for Bill, as it appears you're going to bring him home soon. I ask that you give strength to Rob as he reads scripture to his father in this highly emotional time. Be with his whole family and support and encourage and love them dearly. Lord, we thank you for the healing and the strengthening you've given to Finn Bader. Continue to be with him and his family. We hold him up before you. Be with all who are suffering today, especially those who are suffering physically. If it's your will, send healing. Help us show that they matter to us. We also ask for those who are being challenged by the weather today. Be with them. Be with those who have to work on this day, especially those who work to protect our safety and our health. Keep them safe. Help us who are here personally get home safe as well. We pray all this in your name. Amen. And as you taught us to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We're going to have communion today. We are holding that off until next week. So there will be communion next week. If any of you desire communion that are here personally, talk to me after worship. I will be giving some communion, so just let me know, and I will set up for those who desire it after worship is done. For now, we're going to continue with prayer. O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, pour out the Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us strong in your grace and truth. Protect and comfort us in all temptation, and bestow on us your saving peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. We're going to stay standing for our last song. It is a song that I'm not going to be playing. We're going to be singing a cappella, and I don't know the number. What's the doxology's number? 334 is going to be our hymn number. 334. We're going to get a starting note.
Yeah. Oh, you can. That's your G.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Thank you. I like adding the amen on that one. I'm not even going to tell you to sit. If you want to, feel free. Thank you for joining us online. There's chili downstairs, lots of it. We're just going to go downstairs and eat. So, Lord be with you till we meet again.